Hi guys, so my name is Harjit Singh. I'm going to take you through for I think another 10 minutes. Hopefully you guys aren't nodding off after having a nice lunch out there. I did sample what you did have and seemed quite nice actually. Some of the students out there were really interested in it. So Harjit Singh, I represent a couple of organisations. I've got one up here, if you would have seen it out there, called Turbans and Trust. I'm also National Director of United Sikhs, which is an international organisation affiliated with the United Nations. And another organisation I represent, if you picked up one of my other brochures, is Australian Sikh Heritage. So I'm going to try to cover 5 minutes on each of them, hopefully get some questions from you guys a little bit later on. But the key thing I wanted to start off with is probably a story, and it's to do with education, and it's something that I'm actively involved in quite a bit. And essentially, it's a story about two girls who, you know, recently finished Year 7 last year in an Australian school. Both of them came from different backgrounds in two different schools. And after finishing their 7 years, they basically went to a high school which was in that area. So they'd spent 7 years, you know, going through with their peers, and they'd picked a school which was right nearby. Now, essentially, these two Sikh girls, they were Sikh, and therefore carried some articles of faith on their bodies at all times. And depending on whether you're initiated or not initiated, you might have certain articles of faith on you. We can run through that in a little bit. But essentially, both these girls had articles of faith. One child went in and essentially was given an opportunity to have a discussion with her parents, the students of her class, even the year group, to explain what those articles of faith were. And essentially, you've never heard anything basically happen at that school other than this, you know, child has fitted into high school, you know, beautifully, really having a seamless transition. The other child I wanted to talk about essentially was picked up for a disciplining matter, and that was because she was wearing an item of jewellery. And essentially that item of jewellery was an article of faith. It was the kara that most Sikhs wear. And, you know, the parent was called in after this disciplining environment basically started. The parent came in and tried to, you know, try to sort out the situation. New migrant in that regard, as in he'd recently joined the family and come across from Punjab. His English wasn't, you know, that fantastic. But, you know, he tried the best he could, but instead, you know, turned into a bit of an adversarial situation. And someone like myself was called in to basically advocate for the family. I went into that school and, you know, contacted the principal, had a chat with them, which was quite interesting, starting from an adversarial position, which, you know, suddenly we had a lot of recognition and a light bulb moment as soon as they realised that we're talking about an article of faith and maybe their uniform policy wasn't in line with state standards. What you can probably tell is, you know, these two students gone into Year 8 and essentially had very two different experiences. One child's gone in and had a seamless experience, the other child has had a horrible experience. In fact, that matter has not been resolved yet, not from our side, but from the school side, where the school has not come back to us. Now, I'm not trying to put the blame out there on anybody here. I don't think there is someone that I can point a finger at and say that we have an issue there, but we do have an issue, and that issue is that discussions aren't occurring, and in schools, between parents, between children, and teachers in a manner that I believe is appropriate about these articles of faith. And that's why I really, I think I wanted to really raise a point there that, you know, have a conversation if you can. Just to give you a bit of background, what those articles of faith could be for a Sikh. You obviously got turbans, pretty simple. You can see one on my head, and we've even got a beautiful volunteer who's kept her turban on, trying to steal it, I think. But 3 o'clock, okay. Yeah, I might grab that when I head out. That's all good. Thank you very much. So yeah, we've got the turban, but the five articles of faith, it's plus the turban. So we've got hair, we've got long uncut hair. I've never actually cut my hair in my life. You're probably going, wait on, I've got a friend there who's going, really? Your hair would be down to the ground. But it doesn't actually grow all the way to the ground. It's only when you trim it that it actually grows longer. So my hair's about waist length, and children would be actually a little bit shorter. Got uncut hair, I've got a small comb. And these are essentially articles of faith that initiated Sikhs would wear. So not all Sikhs are initiated, first of all. So not all Sikhs are initiated, but the ones that are will carry all of the 5Ks. But you know, if you're not initiated, you can still carry four of them, which I'm going to tell you. So I've got hair, got a small comb, which I keep up in my hair. I've got a gutta, which is an iron and steel bangle around my wrist. It's not an item of jewellery, as I just mentioned earlier. We've got boxer shorts, essentially. We Sikhs invented boxer shorts. They're just a traditional white undershort. Stop looking down there. I'm feeling a bit uncomfortable. All right. Okay, sweet. And then the fifth article of faith, essentially, is a small ceremonial dagger or sword. Whoa, that's scary, right? Especially from some of the schools you might come from. Not that scary. It is something that has been approved by the WA Police and something that Department of Education has dealt with. You probably remember that there was a bit of a furor kicked up last year in a school in the south, which I helped assist with. That was resolved as well, because these ceremonial daggers and swords, they sound like a machete, but we're talking about something so tiny that you probably couldn't see from even the front row here, especially when they're worn in schools. But anyway, so those are the five articles of faith. And I'd encourage you, if you are in that environment and you do see, you know, a Sikh or even somebody from a different background, to have that conversation about difference. One of my mentors at work, I work as a lawyer and an accountant in the city. One of my great mentors taught me something which is really important. That was the greatest compliment you can ever pay somebody is actually ask about their background. Something these days that we're actually told not to ask about, because in this politically correct world that we live in, you never want to say, hey, what's your background? Because I'm Australian, mate, I'm not Indian, right? And you don't want that to happen. But essentially, if you do ask about people's backgrounds, I think you really do get a richer understanding, and that person is complimented by that, by telling you what's occurring there. Anyway, without taking up too much more of your time, Turbans and Trust is an initiative we started about 3 years ago. And essentially, it's taken Australia by storm, in my opinion. And we've tied about 10,000 turbans, ranging from country towns to city. And interestingly enough, it's actually harder to tie turbans on city folk than country folk. I actually thought it would be the other way. Just to be honest with you, give you guys a bit of feedback, you guys are actually the hardest crew that I've ever tied a turban on, which is quite shocking when you think about the education industry and how willing you should be to accept diversity. But that's okay. Take that as a bit of feedback. I'm learning as well. I'm learning new things. The Turbans and Trust story essentially starts off with saying, what's under the turban, mate? That's a question I get all the time, right? That, people want to know what's under my turban. And it's hilarious, right? Because the answer is pretty simple, like, what's under your hat? It's hair, right? Yeah, it's not that hard. But the thing is that under the turban, we also have a certain amount of commitments that we adhere to, right? And we try to adhere to, because the turban has a huge significance to Australia. And it's something that has been under-recognised, in my opinion. The turban has actually been in Australia longer than the Akubra, the famous Australian hat. It has actually been here longer. It is actually potentially, in my opinion, arguably more Australian than an Akubra, right? And without disrespecting my Indigenous brothers and sisters at the back in any way, but what we do have is a turban that's been here, 200 years at least, but these days cops are, really bad rap in the media. And because it's something that's so visually distinct, we thought, let's get out there and just show people that it's not that scary, allow them to experience it, and have a conversation about difference. And it's not just a difference about my background. We want people to have, we want a national conversation, essentially, where people talk about, where you come from, what your background is, and what makes you unique, what experiences essentially make you who you are. So that's the Turbans and Trust story. And the turban, essentially, courage, compassion, honesty, equality, hard work, and trust. So 200 years ago, these cameleers came across. You might, probably, if we've got some history teachers here, you'll probably tell me they were called Afghan cameleers. My high school history teacher taught me the same thing, except when I used to look at the picture that he used to show me of these Afghan cameleers, I used to go, that guy looks like my granddad. And he took that picture home and showed my dad, and he said, go talk to your history teacher, he'll tell you, they're not Punjabi, I don't think. And my history teacher said, no, mate, they're Afghans, they're from Afghanistan. Interestingly enough, the older I got, I thought, I probably should pick that up again and have a look at it. And the more we've looked into it in under the other banner that I work under, Australian Sikh Heritage, done a lot of research, and there's a whole bunch of information out there that points to the fact that most Afghans weren't actually from Afghanistan. 90% of them were probably from a region which is where Sikhs come from, the Punjab. So interestingly enough, that guy could have been my granddad. Anyway, cool. So yeah, Turbans and Trust is one side. Australian Sikh Heritage is something that I think is really important, and one thing that we are trying to get out there to get teachers as well as schools to talk about a multicultural Australia, not just after the White Australia policy. I grew up thinking, you know, going through the schooling system here, thinking that multiculturalism is a brand new thing. You know, it's something that Bob Hawke brought in or something. It's not something that was here, you know, here before White Australia. And I think that's a myth that we need to bust out there, which is that before White Australia was only white. Before White Australia, the more history we've looked at was a fantastic, colourful, vibrant, multicultural Australia. And it's an exciting Australia. It's something that, you know, we should be proud of. You had, you know, Sikhs, stories of Sikhs, you know, being cremated on people's farms illegally at the time, because there was that much brotherhood between those, you know, white folk and Sikhs at that time. You know, they would go, it doesn't matter, I don't care the fact that, you know, having cremations under the state law is illegal. We would rather let you be buried or cremated the way that, you know, you wanted your last rites basically put through. All right, so the thing we do with United Sikhs, so I've talked about Turbans and Trust and Australian Sikh Heritage quite a bit, but United Sikhs is where I can come out and offer a service where we can have a discussion. If you ever have an issue and you do need some mediation assistance, or if there's some language barriers with discussing things with a South Asian family, we can come out and make sure that, you know, you guys have a positive experience and a mutual outcome where everybody's happy.